Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to live in time. We know what we do here in time is what will determine our lot in eternity. We are therefore praying and calling upon you for help of grace so that we will not be careless with our life in time, so that our eternity will not be that of woes, in Jesus' name. Help us to invest properly in time, so that our eternity will be that of bliss, in Jesus' name. Speak to us right now, O Lord, for we, your children, are hearing. Thank you for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The choristers have already preached my message, and it's entitled Building in Time and for Eternity. Building in time and for eternity. For every man, life separates into two. We live in time, and we will continue to exist after time with us has passed away in eternity. For all of us again, eternity divides into two. Some will live in eternity of bliss with the Heavenly Father God in heaven. It's unfortunate, others will live in eternity of agony, eternity of regrets, eternity of woes in hellfire with Satan. I pray the Lord will help us to apply our hearts unto wisdom, so that our lot in time, our lot in eternity, will not be marred by our living in time, in Jesus' name. Building in time and for eternity. I take my text from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I read from verse 1 through 3. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, reading from verse 1 through 3. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to be born, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. Please let the children, church workers, assist us in keeping the children. Children, church workers, please assist us in taking care of the children. We don't want them to women coordinators. Now I'm in verse 3. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. Here we are told there is time for everything that we do here in this world. And once you don't do what you are supposed to do at the time you need to do it, the opportunity will no longer be there, because time and tide, they say, wait for no man. Therefore, it behoves every one of us to ensure that we do the right thing at the right time. We see this case vividly illustrated in the life of Ezra, the priest, at the time of their returning from captivity from Babylon to Jerusalem. Ezra chapter 3. I'm reading there from verse 8 to 11. Ezra chapter 3, reading from verse 8 through 11. Now, in the second year of their coming into the house of God at Jerusalem, in the second month, began Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Josadak, and the remnant of their brethren, the priests and the Levites, and all that were come out of the captivity unto Jerusalem, and appointed the Levites from 20 years old and upward to set forward to work to the work of the house of the Lord. Then stood Joshua with his sons and his brethren, Kadmiel and his sons, the sons of Judah, together to set forward the workmen in the house of God, the sons of Enadad, with their sons and their brethren, the Levites. And when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, they set the priests in their apparel with trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, with cymbals, to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. Now we know about David. He had an intention to build for God, to build a tabernacle for God. We will talk about that later, though he was not permitted. But eventually, one of his children, Solomon, who succeeded him on the throne, came up and built that, you know, wonderful, glorious tabernacle. It was a masterpiece of his kind. And we thank God for the beauty of it. The day of dedication was a special day. You can read about that in 1 Kings chapter 8. The glory of God, we are told, came down so much that even the priests could no longer continue to preach. It was a time of divine visitation. And David, like all of us today too, we also have the challenge to build for our God. We are doing it in time. But you see, anything you do for God will last throughout eternity. If you do anything for man or for yourself, it will only last for time. You build a house for yourself, that's fine, but it's only for time. You bought a car for yourself, that's good, only for time. You acquire certificates for yourself, that's good, but it's only useful in time. When time passes away with you, the certificate becomes useless. They don't use BSc degree in heaven. BA degrees, master degree, PhD degrees, they are useless, you know, in heaven. But they are useful here on earth. They are good. We are not condemning them. They are important. But those are things we are building only in time. And they only last for time. Some of them will not even last throughout time. I know people, you know, whose house got burnt and their certificates, first degree, second degree, all, everything got burnt, you know, inside the house. And, you know, just like that, most of the things don't even last, you know, so much in time. But whatever we do for God, that one will not only last throughout time, it will also be relevant in eternity. And David recognized that in his time, that he decided it was time for him to build. Well, a time came when the glorious tabernacle that was raised, you know, became vandalized and destroyed, you know, by, you know, Nebuchadnezzar, when he came and then led all the children of Israel into captivity. But then, at the time of Ezra received favor from the face of the king to come back and come and raise up the broken altar, and to raise up the broken wall of Jerusalem. And thank God, he secured, you know, the help and assistance of the Levites and the other tribe of Israel to join him in the building work. Every blood-washed saints today should feel concerned, should feel constrained, and should feel compelled to build for God. There are many things we are building. We are building lives. Building lives, the never-dying souls of men. The principal has just spoken to us about the Deeper Life High School. It's an attempt, it's an effort to build lives that we have significant impact on time, and also, you know, we enter into eternity of glory. We have also heard about Anchor University. We are building in time. But then, what we are building will not only last for time, it will continue to exist till an unending future, eternity. And right there on the campus now, we want to thank God. We've been building lives. And we thank God for many lives that have passed through here. Many people have come here to achieve academic laurels. They have come to achieve fame and all that goes on, you know, with success in life. They have acquired all that. But we thank God, the Lord has also used his church to raise up and build up lives that, by the grace of God, they are impacting positively in time, and they will also continue to survive, to subsist in eternity. Thank God for people that have come here to come and school like you, coming through pre-degree, coming through direct admission, coming through, you know, jump admission and all that, the Lord has, you know, used people to build them up in their most holy faith. And thank God, they are in the kingdom of God right now, shining for God in different parts of the world. Last year, I was privileged to travel out to U.S. in particular. And in about 8 states that I visited, it was a thing of joy for me to see our brethren, those who have passed through OAU here, many of them occupying important positions in the kingdom building, you know, in that great country. I saw many of our brethren, some region overseers. And when we say region, the structure of the church in U.S. is different from that of Nigeria. You know, in U.S. you have so many countries. Church is spreading, but we have not covered so much. And so you have about a number of 8 states will be brought together under one single region. And you have a region overseer, you know, in charge. So, and each of the states, we have its own state overseer. You know, in Nigeria here, state overseer is a higher ministerial status than that of a region overseer. But the reverse is the case because of the level of church growth, you know, that we have up there now. Later on, they will also come to, you know, our own structure. But for now, that's what is going on. So we have some of our brethren, region overseers there. And we have some of our brethren, state overseers, some, you know, district pastors here and there, and they're extending the frontiers of the kingdom there. And when I saw so many of them, they were the people that came to welcome me to, you know, each of the states, you know, in New York, in Washington, D.C., in Massachusetts, Maryland, you know, and so forth. Thank God, you know, you could see that actually the labors of our heroes past are that old booker. It's not in vain at all. We want to believe God and pray to God that God will continue to use the crop of leadership now to see raise up many more souls that will stand as pillars in the kingdom of God, extending the frontiers of the kingdom in different parts of the world in Jesus' name. You are part of the people we are building, and I'm praying for you. You will be a pillar in the kingdom of God, very strong and firm in Jesus' name. But you see, to build the kingdom, to build lives, to build souls, we also need to build structures. Think about it. If there's no place where like this, where we are, you know, sitting down, you know, today, imagine how the fellowship would have looked like. If there's no place like that old booker, where you people gather at old booker, I mean, at OAU, for your Monday Bible study, Thursday revival hour, you know, and all the fellowship, how would the place, you know, look like? Think about it, those of you from Olonade district, if there's no place like that, where will you be gathering? Of course, you'll be using some places, but that will not be the perfect will of God. Think about it, those of you from, you know, Ojoyin Church, Fajuyi, sorry, they are now part of a hospital group, and then the other districts that make up, you know, the LALA group. Think about the different places that the Lord has helped us to raise up. But when we look at the work that is still remains to be done, we will say we still have a long way to go. And we thank God for this place. Actually, this is not the regional headquarters, it's just a district, but a unique, you know, kind of a district. Actually, our headquarters is at Ondo Road. We have the land acquired there some years ago, but lack of finance has hindered us thus far. But we are believing God. This very year, we are raising the foundation of that building. So that instead of having batches of combined service, all of us will be coming together and the place will be able to contain all of us at once. We'll also be able to raise a big building that will contain all the children for the children church in the whole region in one single combined service. That is the goal this year. We are building, and the God of heaven, it will prosper us in Jesus' name. Want to thank God for the effort of our former region coordinator, Brother Olujegede, last year in initiating that gigantic project at Old Buka. I need to let you know that the GS is aware of that project. And yes, if you want to clap, you can clap. The message is still going on. Praise the Lord. And yesterday, we have to speak together and all that on the project. And I told him this is what is going on, and I also let him understand the changes that we have made, the restructuring, I mean the leadership and all that, and that you know how the former leader has resumed to another session of the work now, and another leader has taken over, and the work is you know going on. Not only the region coordinator, even one of the associate coordinator, the one in charge of Koiwo district, we have also reassigned him also to another place now, that's Ajibandele district, and then just like that, and that is the work, you know, that we are all doing. And that is telling us that whether on the campus, whether in the town, whether in the local government, it is one single church in the region. And the arrangement that brings us together in town here is not just man-made. I mean, it's not just my own personal, you know, making. It's just one of the ways Deeper Life operates. And that's everywhere. You know, when you talk about church, church is also an organization. And I was telling them on Wednesday in our leaders' meeting that an organization, it can be defined as an establishment that has an organized way of doing things. You talk of banking industry, you know, it's an organization. And they have their own way of operation, way of doing their own things, different from, you know, the educational industry, the secondary school, university, how they operate. University is an organization. And the ways of doing things in the university is different from the ways of doing things in, you know, any other organization. So when you talk of an organization, it's an establishment that has a unique way of doing things. And it's one of our own unique ways of operation in Deeper Life that once in a month, the whole church in a particular locality will come together like that. As big and expanded as Ibadan, you know, city is, all of them together. And all the campuses, they have more campuses than Ife, you know, that's a mega city. All of them, together with all the churches in town, they will come together at the headquarter church at Gbagi once in a month. And if you are schooled in Ibadan before, maybe you are in Polytechnic, maybe you school in Polytechnic, or you are in UI, or School of Forestry, and School of so many things they have out there, you know, they will all come together. So it's just our own way of operation in Deeper Life. Praise the Lord. So, like I'm saying, the project that our former leader initiated last year is a unique project, a wonderful, you know, project. And we want to thank God for all the people that God has been using. But the project is still ongoing, and all of us must be part and parcel of it. We will not involve campus church in the building of the headquarter church until you have completed, you know, that one. And I'm also promising you, this very year, even the church in town will cooperate with you, send some money for the you know, progress of the work in Jesus' name. And as we are doing that, we are building. Although the building is in time, but the reward will last throughout eternity. That is why you as an individual cannot stand aloof, cannot feel unconcerned. You just have to be part of it. Every other thing we build in this life, you know, it's only for time. It's only what we do for God that shall last. And I'm praying for you that your life at the end of a time will not be a wasted life in Jesus' name. I talked about David. He had a desire to build at his own time. Let's see him. 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7. I read there from verses 1 and 2. And it came to pass, when the king sat in his house, that the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in an house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. Think about that. That's somebody who was eternity conscious. That's somebody who knows that, you know, life will not end with time. He looked at the house where he was living. It was a house of cedar, built with cedar. You know, a place that is, you know, well built, with all the you know, architectural, you know, masterpiece and all the rest. But he now looked and meditated and discovered that the ark of God, which was a symbol of the presence of God, was put just under a shed somewhere. And in fact, this is an aberration. How should I be living in a mansion? And the ark of God, the symbol of God's presence, will just be under the tents. He said, no. Something will have to be done. God is greater than I. The house of God must be more glorifying, more magnificent than where I live. Though I'm a king. Thank God for godly kings like that, who are not only earthly conscious, but they are heavenly minded. So he thought of building a house. But as I said, we'll see later that he wasn't permitted to do that. And as David thought about this, he realized how unseriously, how unsaintly, and how unseemly it is for him to dwell in the house of cedar while the ark of God dwelleth within the curtains. And with a yearning and a yielded heart, he proposed and planned to build a house for God. In that attempt alone, God acknowledged seven things. Number one, he acknowledged his uncommon commitments. Very, very committed. And I told you the other time, one of the pillars of, you know, strong Christianity is the foundation of commitments. You must be committed to God. You cannot just take all the grace of God in vain. Just keep on coming, hearing, enjoying the blessing, doing nothing. No, you must be committed. God acknowledged the uncommon commitment of David in just thinking that a befitting edifice behoves the place where God should dwell. Not only that, God acknowledged his unselfish sacrifice. Many people will think of themselves, but not David. He was not selfish. Number three, God acknowledged his unparalleled perception. He could perceive. He knew what Israel ought to do. He knew the right thing to do at the right time. Not only that, number four, God acknowledged his unalloyed loyalty. He was a loyal person, loyal to God, dependable to God. Then number five, God acknowledged his unprecedented precept. Before that time, no building of such has ever been raised in Israel for God to dwell. The ark of God was only carried from one curtain to another curtain, from one tent to another tent. Not only that, God acknowledged his unprecedented precepts. And number six, God acknowledged his unflinching focus. He was well focused. Then number seven, God acknowledged his unwavering willingness to build a house for him. I pray God will have the same testimony concerning you in time, in Jesus' name. Now as we read on in verse 3, we see that even though David had all this commitment, consecration, sacrifice, for one reason or the other, because he was a man of war, his hand was stained with blood, God did not permit him. But thank God for you, you are permitted. And I'm praying that Satan will not hinder you, self will not limit you in building for God in time and for eternity in Jesus' name. So we read in verse 3. And Nathan said to the king, go, do all that is within thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. Verse 4. And it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, shall thou build me an house for me to dwell in? Whereas I have not dwelt in any house since the time that I brought up the children of Israel out of Egypt, even to this day, but have walked in a tent and in a tabernacle in all these places wherein I have walked with all the children of Israel. Spake I a word with any of the tribes of Israel, whom I commanded to feed my people Israel, saying, why build ye not me an house of cedar? Now therefore, so that thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people, over Israel, and I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest, and have cut off all thine enemies out of thy sight, and have made thee a great name, like unto the name of the great men that are in the heart. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in, that we may dwell in a place of their own, and move no more, neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them anymore, as before time. And since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies, also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. Praise ye the Lord. So we see here that, okay, let's read the remaining two verses. Verse 12. And when the days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So we see, with all that, David proposed, desire, and wanted to do, for the reason of his being bloody, because he fought so many wars, God said, yes, it was a good idea, I appreciate it, I admire it, but you will not do it. Another person who will come out of your bower will do it. And we thank God in due time that Solomon eventually did that. But then, as he had that desire, he was blessed. And you can see the blessing being pronounced on him here. The challenge to us today, brothers and sisters, is to build. And every one of us has to be involved. Nobody is poor to the point that I cannot give. And nobody is rich that what he is giving will be too much. Everybody should be involved. Either in the region headquarters church in town that we want to start, or the project on the campus that is ongoing, is our work together. And we must give generously. The challenge to build today is great. Look at Haggai chapter 1. I read there in verse 8. Haggai chapter 1. Reading there in verse 8. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build a house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. As God spoke to Haggai, so he's speaking to us today. We are to look up. We are to go to the mountain. We are to bring wood. We are to build an house for God. And God says he will take pleasure in it. The need is great, not just because we want something, special, more than anything that exists on the campus. No, it's great because you all know that the university management is having another project, another purpose, to put old Buka, to another use. And because of that, they have given us some time limit to leave the place. And should they ask us to leave that place and then not find another beautiful place? I want to thank God for some of our professors here who have helped us to meet with the management and all that, securing the land. I was fully carried, along in all the thing. And I want to thank God for all that we have done. All that you have done in time will be rewarded in eternity in Jesus' name. Much money has been spent already, and much will still be needed. Last year, myself, with your former leader, Brother Jegede, and also Brother Odedire, we were in Abuja together on this same project to go and negotiate with the contractor who will do the steel roofing, like this. And when we got there, though a member of our church was willing to come and assist us do it, and so that we can be paying on an instrumental basis. And yet, the amount quoted was great. But I believe our God here in OAU is greater than the amount, in Jesus' name. And just last week, our state officer in Abuja phoned me and said, what am I doing? The contractor that will do the steel roofing, is he moving down already and all that? I said, Pastor, we are still believing God because we have not reached the roofing stage yet. And we still need millions of naira to get to the point where his own work will begin. So that's why I said the challenge is great, but God of heaven will prosper us in Jesus' name. Before we get even that very place where you are using now, where you may look at it and feel that it's not to your own taste, but if you know all the effort that went into that place, you will know that it took sacrifice from us in those days. Initially, when we started in 1982, we were using a place called Ivor Valley. How many of us know Ivor Valley? Look at you. Later day generation. You don't know Ivor Valley in OAU. Okay, I will not show it to you. We were using Ivor Valley. But later on, the palm wine drunkards, they also have their own gyration spot there. The other people too, they also have their own spots. And then it became a kind of a nuisance of a place, and the university authority have to take a decision that all the people in Ivor Valley, well, let me tell you, that's just the valley between in front of Maremi Hall and the Earth Center. There's a big gully there that was bubbling for it was a spot, a crossroad of a place for different people on the campus in those days. But eventually, the university authority decided, because of those who were smoking DM, smoking marijuana, and all that, they said, we should evacuate, leave the place. We should leave the place. We have already built our own fellowship center there. That was the place we used to have our Bible study. But when that decision was taken, because of the nuisance of, these palm wine drunkards and all the other people, then we needed to look for another place. Then we sent out a dispatch, party to comb everywhere, look for alternative place. And to the glory of God, we were able to get, that place, now. And when we got there, it was the place where old Buka people used to throw their excreta in those days. When they, it was a place where they used to do short puts. Short puts? When they look here and there, they are pressed, and they just get a sheet of paper and they look here and there, nobody is coming, they just bow down and put the thing there and then carry it, they just fling it, to the back of old Buka. And that was, the place where we discover. And we approached the university authority, thank God for the then director of council affairs, in person of Sir Aborishade. Thank God we bless that man. He was the one we approached, and then we said we have discovered another place, that if the university authority could, give us the place. He negotiated with the planning and development unit, and eventually they said we could take over the place. Come and see heap of excreta that we packed from that place. But we thank God, eventually when we clear all those excreta and all that, buried it, somewhere. I won't tell you where we buried it, because you have big banana bunch there now that some of you are enjoying, and those mango trees. Praise the Lord. So bury all those heap of excreta and clear the whole place. And in those days, things were not, the economy of the nation was not as rosy and buoyant as this. It was really tough. But thank God for the sacrifice of brethren, and the church was not as large as this. We are just about 33 in number. And we have to tax ourselves. Some of us have to sell our, material textbooks. Some have to sell their cassette player. And some people that got bursary in those days, students will be given bursary. They lay down their bursary. I still remember one of us, who is now an HOD in one of the departments in health sciences, our district coordinator in hospital district now. He was a medical student then. And medical students used to enjoy higher bursary. They used to give them 700 naira. 700 naira, big money then. So he collected the 700 naira and just, lay it down. The other students, non-earth science students, 500 naira. Big money. Some will buy a brand new Okada from that 500 naira and see half change. So, in that way, people have to, bring all the money together before we could have that place where you are enjoying now. The sacrifice. And thank God, it's now your own turn to also provide another place, a more edifying, glorifying place for both for you now and for future generations of students that will come after you. Other people labor. You have entered into their labor. And you too, it's your turn to labor so that other people could also enter into it after you have gone. And maybe some of you too will be employed here as lecturers and you will continue with us in Jesus' name. So, it's an opportunity for us to build on the campus. And also when we talk about this place, where we are now, it took a lot of sacrifice. The place we were using before, at Mokpa there, erosion just took it over. Flood of, runoff water just occupied the place, and because the place was inside the marshy place and all that. And it was around that time that I, being a campus coordinator before, was transferred, into the town, to LA group of districts. And I motivated the people and I said, we just have to do something. It wasn't easy. I remember some people sold their properties, those who sold their motorcycles. The district coordinator here then, we have also, transferred him to another part now. It's in more a group of districts, presently. He sold his Okada. That he had, he gave to somebody to be doing Okada for him. He had to sell it. Not only that, there was another brother who sold his, a refrigerator. I bought myself. Thank God things are okay now. My wife used to have a shop at Aluta Market. In those days, when the lecturers will say, my take-home pay could not take me home. Thank God their take-home pay can take them home now. So, to augment that time, we had a standard shop there where we had a maid who was helping us to do selling and all that. When we came here, we were looking for money. We have already taken loan from cooperative, but the money was not going anywhere. I had to discuss with my wife and say, this is your shop. If we sell it, we can put the money. And eventually we agreed together and then we put for sale on it. Guess how much we sold this? Big money, 150,000 naira. And we brought all the money here to have this kind of a place. And we thank God. After that, multitudes have come here to be saved. Multitudes have come here to be built up in their most holy faith. Multitudes have come here, to be healed of their diseases, and all that. Then eventually a time came we felt we need to expand the place so that it will serve, especially for workers' meeting, leaders' meeting, because it's central to the town. Just like Old Buka is to the campus, so this LALA location is to the entire township. People coming from Okpa, people coming from Ondoro, those coming from the campus, those coming from Ajibandele. It's like a kind of a center of a place. We said we needed, to expand it. And I want to thank God for some of us from the campus, some of our lecturers. I have to, talk to them, to contribute and all that. And we all join hands together to build where we are now. It's, the challenge is still there. It's now your turn. And I have not retired. You don't retire in the work of God. You keep on doing it until the last day on earth. So, we are still together, building in time and for eternity. I pray the Lord will accept our offering and be delighted in our sacrifice in Jesus' name. The challenge to build, I say, is great. Number two, the challenge to build is grave. It's grave. We find that in Haggai 1, verse 9. Ye look for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why? Said the Lord of hosts, because of my house that is waste, and ye run every man unto his own house. God had controversy with them. They didn't build his own house. And then, because of that, all their works, all their labor, God said, I'm not going to bring prosperity on it. So, the challenge is grave. Not only that, number three, the chance to build is granted. The chance to build is granted. Look at verses 18. Verse 8. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. So you can see the chance to build was granted to these people. And we want to thank God at OAU, the chance to build has been granted to us. Thank God for our professors who help us, you know, to get that kind of land. It's not easy. And if you look at other fellowships that had, you know, one land or the other, you will see their own is not as expansive as our own. Which shows that actually God is in the project. He wants us to build, and we shall build in Jesus' name. Not only that, I said, the challenge to build is great, the charge to build is great, and the chance to build is great. Well, because of time, let me look at 3 points in short form. Number one, demand and desire to build God's church. Number two, decision and determination of builders of God's church. Lastly, number three, diligence and dividends in building God's church. Let's look at point number one now. Demand and desire to build God's church. In Exodus 35, from verse 4 to 12, and also verse 12, you will see there, you know, the desire to build. That David desired to build. And even though he was not allowed, you will see people, you know, bringing, you know, materials. Then again, in Ezra that we have read, in verses 2 and 3, you will see Ezra also had desire in his heart to build. In Nehemiah was another man of God in his own time who desired to build. Ezra built the tabernacle, whereas Nehemiah built the broken wall. There is a clarion call and command to us today to build his church. And it is only the deaf, the deceived, and the deluded that will ignore such a fatherly, favored, and fortunate call. I pray none of us will be recalcitrant to this call in Jesus' name. The desire becomes necessary because of 8 points that I want to give you now. Number one, God demands it. That you find in Haggai chapter 1 verse 8. Number two, it is a token of our appreciation to God. You cannot tell me that you appreciate God when you cannot plow back into his kingdom. When you cannot contribute into the building of his house. So, when we contribute, when we give, and we don't give casually, we give painstakingly, generously. It is a token of our appreciation to God. Number three, it is part of our acceptable offering. There are offerings that are not acceptable. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, that be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, and be not conformed to this world, and prove that, so that you may prove that, which is a godly and acceptable will of God. An acceptable will of God is participation in church building. Not only that, number four, responsibility demands it. It's our duty. We just have to do it. Number five, it is a reproach to us if we don't build. It becomes a reproach. How will it look like that when grace that they give us, the time of probation they gave us at Old Booker, when that time expires and they are now chasing us, go, and then it becomes talk of the campus, does that bring glory to our God? The best thing is for us to have finished our building and go there before the planning authority will come and be demolishing, you know, all the ramshackle buildings that are there. So it is a reproach to us if we don't build. It becomes a reproach. Then number six, it consolidates the evangelistic work. All our soul winning, all the freshers conference that we are organizing, and all the special program that we are organizing, the Singspiration and all that. It is when we have a befitting edifice where we can bring the people together that work can be consolidated. Then number seven, it makes our worship of the Almighty meaningful. Makes the worship of the Almighty meaningful. Then number eight, it opens the door of blessing for God's people. And as we give, the blessing of God will never cease upon your life in Jesus' name. That takes me to point number two, decision and determination of builder of God's church. We must decide. We must determine to be involved in the building. Don't say, I am a student. I want to tell you, the old booker that you are using now was built by students. In those days, we didn't have staff members in our midst. We were all students, and just about 33 of us, as I said, not as many as we are now, just 33 people and all students. But commitment, consecration, you can imagine people collecting their bodies, laying it down, people selling their properties, laying it down before we could raise up, you know, that place. I pray at this our own time, when the call is coming again, none of us will be recalcitrant in Jesus' name. Decision and determination are pivotal in the execution of any project. And we see how decision comes into play in Nehemiah's buildings project. You can just spell the word decision phatically, and then we begin to see how everything came up. D stands for deal with the enemy of progress. The enemy of progress. What is that enemy of progress? Procrastination. And we will do it later. Let's start in March. April will be okay. In April, people will go on holiday. Let's wait until second semester. All that kind of procrastination is an enemy. Let's see Nehemiah. Nehemiah. Chapter 2. I read there in verse 1. And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. This man became so disturbed, so sad. Why was he sad? Because there is a project, the broken wall of Jerusalem, that he wanted to build. And he made up his mind, nothing will hinder it. Until he had to, you know, by emotion, by whatever, persuade the king so that he could be released from the kingdom of Artaxerxes to go and do the work in Jerusalem. Not only that, the next word is E. Excuse all excuses that might be generated. Any excuse. I don't have money now. When they send money to me, the little you have now, put it down. Excuse all excuses that may be generated. C stands for commitment and consecration. You can read from verse 11 of Nehemiah chapter 2. You will see their commitment and their consecration there. In verse 12, look at what he says. And I arose in the night, and I and some few men with me, neither told I any man what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. In those days, there was no car, no buses. They traveled by, you know, animals, donkeys, horses, and all the rest. And he said, there was no any other animal around, except the only one to ride. And in the dead of the night, he even exposed himself to danger. That's commitment. That's consecration. And you read down like that, he took, you know, that great decision and determination to be able to build. Look at verse 18. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me. So as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me, and they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. We also will strengthen our hands for this good work. The structure on the campus is a good work. We will strengthen our hands. We have given before. When our former leader was there, I know how much we gave. I was following up on everything that was going on. Those of us, the lecturers, the non-academic staffs, and the students, I know how the money came in and all that. And I was also involved in soliciting here and there, meeting, our church pastor in Ibadan, in Oshogbo, and all the rest, for the little help that we were able to source some funds from the church. And but I want to really thank God and appreciate those of us, the non-students and the students as well, for what we have done. We have done much. But it is not yet over until it is over. And when the new leader took over the mantle of leadership, he has also, gathered all of you together. I was closely monitoring everything, and I saw the pledges and the, dedication that we made. Great and fantastic. We have to keep on like that until we are able to go in there and be having our Sunday service, our Monday Bible study, Thursday revival hour there, like that. It is not over until it is over. Let's keep at it. To start is good. To end well is much more important. I was even telling our new pastor, about how we will need, some special buses by the time we move in there. Because it's not as close by as Old Buka. And so we need big buses to carry people from Moremi Hall, from Angola Hall, from Alumni Hall, to the place. It's still part of building for God. And we will do that graciously in Jesus' name. Then the next letter is I. That means inspiration from past performance. Draw inspiration from past performance. Those who have been doing it before, draw inspiration. See how they gave. See their commitment. As I have shared with you testimonies now of how people, gave their substance, sold their properties in order to build. Draw inspiration from that. And also do something. And all of you students, we cannot be as many as this, and we cannot get something mighty, something, substantial done for our God. The God of heaven will prosper us in Jesus' name. The next letter is seen through the eyes of faith. See possibilities. Don't see impossibilities. Don't say this thing is not possible. It is possible. What the heart can conceive can also achieve. It is possible. The next letter is I, intercession. Let us pray for the project. Let's pray for the project. Of recent, I was told that, one of the university principal officers came around and said, why all these structures, here? That in other universities, it's only, All souls and the Catholic and also mosque that are permitted. Why is it all these other ones are building and all that? And then he went to his office and then took some decision. And then the next day, we are saying, stop work on all the, projects there. But he looked at the Redeem project, and he looked at Deeper Life project, that this one, they have gone far. Therefore, these two, they are exempted. If you want to clap, clap very well. Praise the Lord. Imagine that we are still at foundation level. What will have happened? Stop work. We will not stop work. We'll keep on working in Jesus' name. That is why delays are dangerous. Let's rise up and build when we have the opportunity. And God of heaven, we accept our sacrifice in giving in Jesus' name. It was also similar to what we have in Ondo Road, the other time. Those of you who were still on the campus then, we came together for a combined service when the local government, wanted to take over the place from us. And they came and put, one signboard there. We have uprooted the thing and thrown it away since then. And thank God for prayer, we still have the place. But before we begin to face any other embarrassment, we want to rise up and build. So all of us in LLA group, as I'm talking to the campus, I'm talking to you too. There's a challenge before us to build, and it's an opportunity. And let us seize it at this time. So as we are building, we are praying, supporting the work with prayer. O is the next letter, and it means operation. That means performance. Get the work done. Don't just talk about it, do it. Don't just admire it, participate. Then the last letter of the word decision is N, which stands for nobility. Nobility. That means we are playing men for our people. You are doing things that will glorify, you know, God. Maybe some of us, our children, years later, after we have graduated, we have gotten married, we are established in the families, maybe your children will come to AAU, we worship in that building as well, in Jesus' name. Without decision and determination, excuses like lack of fund will come up. And you find that in Haggai chapter 2, verse 8, complaining of lack of fund. Not only that, excuses like lean resources will come up. That's, the money is not enough. We are students, majority are students. What can we do? Without determination and decision, excuses like lack of professionals will come up. But when there is determination, there won't be lack of funds, there won't be lean resources, and there won't be lack of professionals, because we are doing it by determination, and the God of heaven will prosper us in Jesus' name. As we continue in the project, there are some things we must, clear, out, where this becomes necessary, because I'm not only addressing campus people, I know we have addressed many of these things, but the one in town as well. We have to avoid living Sambalat and Tobiat that opposes and criticizes. There are some living Sambalat. You know, the Sambalat of the Bible, that one is dead. Is that not so? But there are some living Sambalat and Tobiat who we oppose, who we criticize, who we say, don't make, we are here to study. Why all this one now? Why don't we just remain at Old Buka? Avoid living Sambalat and Tobiat. Not only that, avoid likely competing priorities. There are competing priorities. Church work is a multifarious, work. You have this need, you have that need, you have that one to cater for and all that. If we don't get aside all the competing priorities, we will not be able to concentrate on this one and make it a major priority. Number three, legal issues relating to the land acquisition. All that must be settled. Well, I said that may not affect the campus people because they have taken care of that already. Not only that, number what next now? Number four, lukewarm attitude of members to new projects must be avoided. Those who are lukewarm. Not only that, number five, lethargy that manifests in lack of interest must be avoided. Number six, little faith that cannot see what God wants to do. Let's get rid of it. Number seven, we must avoid living with the fear of unknown. That if I give this money now, am I sure I'm going to get any money again? When am I sure I'll get any other, another money from my sponsors? Then we must avoid lack of continuation of the previous leader's work. The previous leaders have done much. We must avoid lack of continuation of it. We must just continue. Government is a continuum. One leader go, other leader comes. And church leadership too is a continuum. We don't say that is a project of the former leader. No. The church of God is one. And as I told you now, even the GS is involved in the project. He's well aware of what is going on. In the last retreat, last December retreat, those of you who are present, you will see how the state overseer, you know, spoke about the project. He took time off after visiting us at the campground to go and look at the building at the campus. And not only that, even our zonal coordinator, that's for the southwest here, we have a state overseer who is coordinating, you know, the work. That's our state overseer in Kwara State. He's also involved, you know, in the project, and he has released, you know, some amount of money for us for the project. So it's not just a one man affair. It's not a vision, you know, of one leader. Therefore, we must avoid the mistake of lack of continuation of the previous leader's work. A man of vision will receive enough inner strength to turn away these seeming barriers and blockade in order to achieve God's desired goal. For effective church building projects, there must be seven things. One, purpose. Number two, projection. Number three, prayer. Number four, planning. Number five, prioritization. Number six, pursuit. Number seven, perseverance. All these must be embedded in this world. Purpose. Purpose means the reason for building. What are we building? We are building for God and for and His kingdom. Then number two, projection. That is, type of house to build. We want to build a bungalow. That will not cost as much as building a skyscraper. And what we are building at Old Buka and want to build at Ondo Road is not a small project at all. And the bigger the project, the bigger, you know, the consecration, the commitments. Then number three, I talk about prayer. That means we move people. You know, prayer that we move people to really give. And in our night vigils, in our Sunday services, let's be having slot of prayer for this building. And not just casual prayer, prayer that will really touch the heart of people to know that this thing God is demanding from them. Not only that, number four, planning. That is stage by stage implementation of the work. Then prioritization. We set the first thing first. Then pursuit. Implementation of the project as planned. We keep on pursuing it, working towards it. Then number seven, perseverance. That means opposition will surely come, but we keep on at it. Time of tiredness will come, maybe even discouragement will want to come, but we keep at it. We persevere. You know, when we are building our building at Olonade Church, we face a lot of opposition. Some people rose up and then, you know, they use their political might. They want to hijack the land from us after we have raised it almost to a roofing level. And it wasn't an easy time, you know, going to the palace to secure the, you know, intervention of the king, you know, and all that. Your campus coordinator now did a lot of work during that time. Yes, he wrote a defense, you know, paper that looks like a term paper. When they brought the thing before Oni Ofife, I said, this is actually PhD thesis. And the people that were opposing us and all that, and they were saying something, Oni said, do you know I can be, he used one language, he said, do you know yes, thank you. He said, do you know I can be nasty? When the Oni said that, the man was quaking in the ground, because what he said even the educational people in Oshogbo, they are already aware, because this church is located beside, you know, a school. He said even the people in the educational ministry in Oshogbo are already aware about this thing, that it's not what Oni can interfere in it. Oni said, you are talking like that to me? Do you know I can be nasty? The man was quaking on the ground. That's how they gave us, you know, a continue, you know, order. They gave us order to go and continue. He said, I dare not see you threaten, you know, injuring them again. But it took prayer for us to achieve that feat. Praise the Lord. That takes me to the last point, diligence and dividends in building God's church. There are a lot of blessings that accrue to you when you are building or you are involved in building God's church. Let's go back to Haggai chapter 2. Haggai chapter 2. I want to read there in verses 18 and 19. Haggai chapter 2. Reading verses 18 and 19. Consider now, from this day and upward, from the 420th day of the ninth month, even from the day that the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid, consider it. Is the seed yet in the barn? Yea, as yet the vine and the fig tree and the pomegranate and the olive tree hath not brought forth, from this day will I bless you. Are you sleeping? God says, from this day will I bless you. Amen. For getting involved in the work of God, from this day will I bless you. Amen. And God cannot lie. If he says he will bless you, he will bless you. It will bless you financially. It will bless you academically. It will bless you socially. It will bless you mentally. It will bless you infrastructurally. It will bless you in all fronts in Jesus' name. That's the promise of God. That's the dividends that accrue to you when you are building. The pastor of any church is a arrowhead in any building project of the church. And necessity is laid on him to desire, like David, to aspire, set a goal, to require experts that will be needed with due consultation. Then he must also acquire, that is, the motivational ability to steer up people to build. Number five, he must inspire other people by contributing meaningfully. Number six, he must perspire in prayer. There is no aspect of God's word that is physical. Even building is a spiritual word when it talks about building of church. Then lastly, number seven, he must refire. Even on the face of challenges and difficulties, he must refire. The onus, therefore, is on us to motivate and mobilize ourselves. And in doing this, we need to commend the people for past contributions and cooperation. We appreciate what we have done before, but we need to do more. Not only that, we must consider the best fundraising strategy that will help us to generate the money that we need. Then number three, we must carefully specify material to use. Don't just use just ordinary run-of-the-mill material. Don't use local-made materials. Go for quality. Go for the one that will... Don't use roofing material that will begin to leak in no longer time. Get quality materials, long span, and what have you. Then, carry along the human resources in the churches. Everybody must be involved. Newcomer, oldcomer, everybody, we must be involved. It's our work together. We don't do fundraising. We don't call on believers to come and do God's work. But we who are God's children, we are the one that will do God's work. And by God's grace, we will do this work together in Jesus' name. Then, cut any possible waste. Possible waste. We must cut it. Then, there must be consistent use of precious material. Then we counsel those who are not willing to participate. Counsel them. Motivate them. Encourage them. All people don't catch the same fish at the same time. Some may catch it early. Others will catch it along the way. Some other people, it is at the tail end of that project that they will catch the fish. So keep on encouraging them. Then cause people to share testimonies of blessing from past contributions. In our Thursday revival service, please, our leaders should ensure this. Call people to come and share testimonies. When we were in Lagos, our GS, because building work is going on, Anchor University, Deeper Life High School, and then church buildings, you know, in every region, everywhere in Lagos. Our GS share testimony of somebody that gave, a graduate of many years who couldn't secure a job. Though he had certificates, but he couldn't secure any job with the good certificates. He has gone for many, many interviews, and they couldn't take him. Eventually, he now resolved into Okada riding. You know, riding Okada in Lagos could be dangerous. But you see, man must work. So he had to look for, you know, money, and he got one Okada, and he was riding the Okada. Then eventually the GS challenged them in Lagos that they had to give for Gbagada project, you know, and the hostel, you know, at the IBTC and all that. And this man, who has no other means of livelihood other than that Okada, took that Okada, sold the Okada, and all the money he got from that sale of Okada, he brought it and dropped it into the offering bag. GS said if he knew that maybe he wouldn't have allowed him to, you know, go that far. But this man just took that decision of faith, dumped everything, and then he began to look up to God for how he's going to survive. All of a sudden, one of the interviews he has done about 3 years ago, then they now sent for him that, are you still interested? Guess what the answer was? Of course, yes. So they invited him for the interview, and then he passed the interview, and then they employed him. And not only that, they gave him a house. And not only that, they gave him a car. And not only that, they gave him a driver. Praise the Lord. He became a chief executive officer overnight, just because of sacrifice in giving to God. Brothers and sisters, I don't know to what extent God will take you and bless you as you are participating in this project, because it's not man's project, it's God's project. And God cannot allow you to give like that and without rewarding you. He will surely reward you beyond your expectation, beyond your imagination, in Jesus' name. And as we are doing the work, we are causing people to share testimony. We must have confession of faith to succeed. Confession of faith. Don't want anybody to say that it's not possible, it will take us time, it will not be done. It shall be done. It is well. We are well able, and it shall be done in Jesus' name. When one then build for God, what will happen? 5 things. Number one, God will be happy. You want God to be happy at you? Let me see your hand up. God will be happy with you in Jesus' name. He will be well pleased with your sacrifice in giving in Jesus' name. So when you have given like that, God will be happy. Not only that, number two, God will honor the person. God will honor you. The testimony of the brother that gave in Lagos, I just shared now, that's a way of God honoring someone. And in your own case, he may just honor you with promotion. He may honor you with extraordinary, excellent performance in your exams. As for you, God may just open the door of, you know, great opportunities for you, international opportunities for you, professor, for you, lecturers, here and there, that you really make a mark, even in your profession. That's one of the ways by which he can honor you, and he can even honor you by opening doors of, you know, they are talking of vacancies now, and I'm waiting for a time when a member of Deeper Life Bible Church will become the vice chancellor of OAU. Amen. God will do it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm waiting for that time when a member of Deeper Life, you know, campus church or Bible church will become the registrar of OAU. Amen. When a member of Deeper Life Bible Church will become the bosser of OAU. Amen. When a member of Deeper Life Bible Church will become the deputy vice chancellor of OAU, it will happen in Jesus' name. And when a member of Deeper Life Bible Church will become the director of you know, teaching hospital over there, it will happen. And God will do it. And as we continue to serve him, laboring for him, sacrificing for him, that he will get that one done by honoring us. Not only that, number three, there will be heavenly resources that will be opened unto you. When we serve him like that, heavenly resources will be opened to us. Then number four, there will be healthy rivalry in the church among members, that you are giving, have you paid your own pledge? I'm struggling, I've paid three quarter. As for me, I've paid 90% of my pledge, you know, in this project. And you know, we are just you know, competing, godly rivalry to give to God, to serve the Lord, that will be in the church. Then not only that, there will be house and heavenly mansion that will be prepared for us up there in heaven. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. He said, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a home for you. I pray for you on that day. When we shall get to the pearly gate, your own mansion will not elude you in Jesus' name. Building in time and for eternity. Let's rise up on our feet and pledge our allegiance unto God that will be involved in this project. We will give sacrificially in this project. We will commit ourselves into it. Nothing is too small and nothing is too great. We will cooperate with our leaders and we will join hands with him in building for God and for eternity. God has spoken to you. It is time for you to speak back to God, to pledge your allegiance, to promise the Lord, to assure him as an obedient child that all he has spoken to you, you will do. And then be expecting his blessing. Be waiting for that time when he will lift you up, when he will honor you. You are a new convert? Yes, you are concerned as well in giving. And as you give, the Lord will reward your cheerful sacrifice. Commit yourself to the Lord. Promise the Lord, I will not fold my hands. I will not ignore the call. I will not be idle in building. I will do my part. God doing his own part already. And the deed will be done. We are building university. It's part of the building. We are building the Deeper Life High School. It's part of the building. We are building our fellowship center on the campus. That is part of the building. And we are building the headquarters church here in Ife at Ondo Road. It's part of the building. We are building together. Building together. Building together. We are doing it in time. But the effort will last all throughout eternity. Because whatever is done for God shall last. If you build your own personal house, that's just for time. That's just for time. It's good, do it, but it's just for time. When the Antichrist comes to the stage, he will take over that house. But the church of God that you are building, that blessing will be for eternity. Antichrist cannot take over the church of the living God. In fact, all of us will have gone by rapture before the Antichrist takes over the center stage of the world. Building in time and for eternity. Building in time and for eternity. Pray you will be involved. Pray you will not be idle. How much have you given thus far? And how much do you still want to give more? Are you giving according to your several ability? Or as a lecturer, you are giving what a student can give? That's not fair. Some students are giving 100,000. And you, a professor, you are also giving 100,000. Is that proportionate? Is that according to your ability? No, let us not be stingy in the work of God. If a student gives 100,000, professor should give 5 million. It's not too much. God does not owe anybody. He will reward you abundantly. He said, give, it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Press down. Running over. shall God give unto your bosom. Because with the same measure you meet unto God, with the same shovel you shovel unto God, with that same measure it will shovel back at you. You cannot outgive God. You give him your money, he gives you his blessing, and his blessing will outweigh your own money. Pledge your allegiance. Tell God you will be involved. And tomorrow, in eternity, when God will be rewarding his own people at the pearly gates, you will shake my hand. You will say, "Pastor, you told me that time. I obey. See the stars on my crown." It will be testimony galore at the pearly gates. We labor together. We sacrifice together. We did the payment together. And now God is rewarding us. He will be rewarding us together. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Pressed down. Shaking together. Running over. For with the same measure you meet, it shall be measured unto you again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All the pre-degree students, you are concentrated at the upper gallery. I'm here to pray for you today. I've told you to give, and I know you will give. And you can hear testimony from those who are already in now. Last year, we pray for them.